is even more better. And we also need to see rise in estradiol level and continue the same dose for 2 to 3 days and re-scan to see whether the follicles are growing. So how do we know the estrogen levels are rising? Two ways. One is a blood test, which may not be available in many places. So the indirect measure is to look at the endometrial thickness. Sometimes straight away gives us that there is estrogen, very likely. However, it's not 100% always. So when you, depending on what facilities you have available, you can make use of those facilities. So a dose of 75 international units per day generally leads to development of 1 to 2 follicles only unless the woman is very young. So if you're starting with the HMG, 75 is the starting dose. However, if you're using a recombinant FSH, 50 international units is the starting dose. So how do we manage poor response? We can increase the dose, but step up by 30 to 50%. Multi-dose preparations will be helpful where there is a pen device where you can just adjust and inject without much hassle. But we must be prepared, and we also need to prepare the patients that they may respond suddenly and explosive above what we want. That is more than 3 follicles. Sometimes they may also develop 5 to 6 follicles. So once the dose has been increased, we can again monitor after 3 to 4 days. So even if one follicle is developing, we don't need to increase the dose. Only if we do not have any follicle more than 10 millimeter, we can increase the dose. So there are various regimes which include clomiphene or letrozole with gonadotropin. So these are all the various combinations, but whatever it is, letrozole, it only leads to single follicle development in most of the cases, so we don't need to be worried. But do not put on very high doses of clomiphene along with gonadotropin. And I would personally suggest use either of them by themselves in the first cycle, and only if the response is not satisfactory, you can add both together. So that can be letrozole followed by gonadotropin or along with gonadotropin. Say for example, we start on day 3, letrozole or clomiphene, and we can also start gonadotropin. However, we can also start after the 5-day course of letrozole or clomiphene is finished. However, most of the studies in IUI, we've started gonadotropin on day 3 itself when you see the data. What is the success rate with gonadotropin? In those cycles, they started on day 3 along with letrozole or clomiphene. So action of both is complementary. It's difficult to titrate. Start with softer stimulations, that is lower doses. There's no standard guideline. So one needs to be very careful which group of patients you are using these medications. In someone who is very young and PCO, you may not want to use both together. You may want to use gonadotropin with a starting dose, but still we need to be cautious. They may not respond or they may over-respond. Or in someone with a higher maternal age where the ovarian reserve is normal and they've developed only a single follicle with ovulation induction agents before, like letrozole or clomiphene, then you can club both together. So it's just how each patient responds to the medications previously, because most of the patients will have had some form of ovulation induction before moving to IUI. So that we need to. So a sonography forms the mainstay of monitoring. We need to scan on day 2 or day 3 before we start, and 5 days later. And we need to accurately measure the number of follicles, the size, as well as the endometrial thickness. And we also may need to do estradiol levels, but mainly only in gonadotropin cycles. It's usually helpful in preventing OHSS. And ideal rise should be 30 to 50% per day. So when do we trigger? When the follicle is at least more than 18 millimeters and endometrium more than 8 millimeters. Say for example, the follicle is 17 millimeters and the endometrium is 8 millimeters, you may wait another day before you trigger to give that endometrium a bit more chance. So what ovulation trigger agents are we using? HCG 5,000 to 10,000 international units, or recombinant HCG as well, we can use 6,500 international units or 250 micrograms. Ovulation usually occurs 38 to 40 hours later because they've got a longer half-life, and they also, HCG also gives luteal support to a certain extent. We can also trigger with GnRH analog. The time interval between GnRH administration and ovulation is the same as HCG, that is 38 to 40 hours later. It is also luteolytic, but the action is for only very short duration. It lowers the risk of hypostimulation syndrome. However, it does not give much support in the form of luteal support. So how can we prevent multiple pregnancies and OHSs? IUI should be withheld when more than 2 to 3 dominant follicles are more than 15 millimeters, or more than 5 follicles more than 10 millimeters at the time of HCG or LH surge. So when gonadotropins are used in IUI, 75 IU or lower should be used because higher doses have similar pregnancy rates, but increase in multiple pregnancy rates. So starting regime does not need to be more than 75, otherwise we'll be coming across a lot of multiple pregnancies. And what is a good practice point is, as an alternative to cycle cancellation, one can consider aspiration of excess follicles at the time of HCG or LH surge, which might be additional option for reducing the risk of multiple pregnancy. So if there are 5 or 6 follicles, we did have in one of the patients and she was very adamant not to have the cycle cancelled. She would not listen even if we advised her not to have intercourse during that cycle. Even though we do not do IUI, we didn't feel it was safe to leave her. So we had to do follicle reduction. So is luteal support needed for the patients? All the IUI patients, it's not required as per the literature. However, when luteal phase deficiency is suspected or when primary indication is anovulation, then yes, luteal phase is likely to help. So the luteal phase support in the form of micronized progesterone 200 milligrams per day or 1,000 to 5,000 international units once every 4 to 5 days after IUI. So if you see, these are the results from 2002, where the pregnancy rate per cycle was 14% with FSH, whereas with clomiphene it was only 6%. So this was in IUI with husband sperm. If you see the twin rate, it was more or less similar. So FSH is giving better results compared to clomiphene. So again, the number of cycles we can perform. This is an analysis of nearly 9,963 cycles. The first cycle, the success rate was 51%, in the second 19%, and third 12%. But thereafter, you can see it's significantly decreasing. So performing more than 3 cycles, at the max 4 cycles, is not recommended. So what are the other factors that can influence the IUI success rate? It's the age of the female as well as male, and the sperm DNA fragmentation and human papilloma virus in semen. These are the latest developments which I just wanted to put across, just in case we might be wondering why they are not conceiving, though we follow all standard protocols. Just to show the results when live birth rates by IUI with the normal DNA fragmentation is 19%, with abnormal DNA fragmentation, it's only 1.5%. And if we compare, it seems better for high DNA fragmentation compared to conventional IVF. Hence, the pregnancy rates are higher with ICSI, which is 42%, compared to 26% with a conventional IVF when the DNA fragmentation is high. So again, if we compare, if there is HPV in the semen sample, if we are using partner sperm and it's positive for HPV, the clinical pregnancy rate is only 3.2%. However, if it's negative, the clinical pregnancy rate was 8.8%. In the same donor sperm, if it's positive for HPV, there were no clinical pregnancies. However, if it was negative for HPV, 14.6% clinical pregnancy was seen. So HPV also is thought to play a key role in the success of IUI. So these are the recent studies which I've done. They're not into practice yet, but something that will significantly influence how we are going to do IUI cycles in future. And that's all about IUI. Now I would like to move to IVF. So coming to stimulation in ART. So what is it that we are trying to achieve during stimulation in ART? First, we would like to prevent an untimely LH surge so that ovulation does not happen, and we, before ovulation itself, we can aspirate the follicles and retrieve the oocytes. So that is the main aim of untimely prevention of LH surge. How we can do that is by two ways, either give a GnRH agonist or an antagonist. So that is prevention of LH surge. So we want now the stimulation of follicles. How are we going to do that? It's either using recombinant or urinary gonadotrophins, which is either FSH or HMG. And what doses are we going to use? So, GnRH action, how it acts is, it's synthesized by the arcuate nucleus of hypothalamus and is released in a pulsatile manner. It stimulates the FSH and LH production from anterior pituitary. So there are receptors in the pituitary cells to which they go and attach and stimulate it to release the FSH and LH. However, as the receptors, when we are continuously administering the GnRH agonist, the receptors are depleted, and that's when no endogenous FSH or LH will be released, and this is when downregulation starts. So that's what we want. We want no action from the pituitary level.
Ma'am, screen is not shared, ma'am.
Untimely LH surge. So ma'am, initially when we administer GnRH and lung, there will be an upregulation and flare effect, that is release of FSH and LH. With continuous administration, the receptors internalize and downregulation starts and then suppresses the release of pituitary gonadotrophins.
Ma'am, sorry for the interrupt.
So agonist cycles, we have to do a day 2 FSH and LH, and they need to be in the range of 1 to 2 milliunits per ml, because prior to day 2 itself, a week before, we will be starting agonist, and by this time there should be suppression. So FSH and LH levels need to be really low, whereas in an antagonist cycle, FSH and LH levels are high. So the endogenous levels contribute significantly to the gonadotrophin pool in poor responders. When I come to my talk later, antagonists are recommended in poor responders because the FSH LH levels, which are higher, are likely to also stimulate. Just a second. Hello?
Yes, ma'am. Please continue, ma'am.
Is that okay? Is that okay? Thank you. Sorry for the interruption. I understand the screen was not seen. I'll go through these slides. So I'll start from this slide where it's an agonist protocol where we administer GnRH agalog, which results in upregulation and flare effect. When it's continuously administered, receptors internalize and downregulation starts when FSH and LH are not released, and LH surge is unlikely to happen. In agonist cycles, on day two, FSH and LH levels need to be around 1 to 2 milliunits per ml, whereas in antagonist cycles, they're very high, and these endogenous levels will contribute to the gonadotrophin pool in poor responders. How about antagonists? There are advantages with antagonists, and that's what we use routinely for majority of our patients because of shorter duration of treatment, lower dose of gonadotrophins are required, and we can rapidly reverse the effect of antagonists, and they can be considered in poor responders as the higher FSH LH levels can maintain follicular pool. And we can also prevent OHSs because if you are using an antagonist cycle, we can use GnRH agonist as an ovulation trigger. However, if you are using a GnRH agonist cycle, it will not be helpful as a trigger because of the downregulation. So when we are using a GnRH long protocol, we start day 21 of a 28-day cycle in the previous cycle. And then once the period starts on day two, we add gonadotrophins to the agonist. So the agonists are continued from day 21 to 22 of previous cycle all along to the current cycle and continued till the trigger along with gonadotrophins from day two or day three. In a short GnRH agonist protocol, GnRH agonist as well as the gonadotrophins are started more or less from day 2 or day 3 of the cycle till HCG is given. And it's an antagonist multiple dose fixed protocol cycle. We start gonadotrophins first on day 2 or day 3 and followed by GnRH antagonist on day 6 of the cycle till HCG is given. And in a flexible protocol, we start with the gonadotrophins. However, we don't give an antagonist till at least one follicle is more than 14 millimeters. And we continue both till we give HCG. If we look at the which is better between flexible and fixed protocol, in the recent ESHRAE, they seem to be slightly better with the fixed protocol, but it's not significantly different to flexible protocol. So one need not worry too much to try a fixed protocol rather than a flexible protocol. So what is the starting dose? It depends on the age, antral follicle count, and anti-Müllerian hormone levels. And what are the risk factors for ovarian hyperstimulation syndrome? Previous OHSs, polycystic ovaries, AMH more than 15 picomole per ml, very young patient, low BMI, and history of allergies. So this is a very important study that I would like to share. Ethnicity is a determinant of ovarian reserve. Differences in ovarian aging between Spanish and Indian women. So there is a significant difference. If you see, the red color one is the Indian and the blue is the Spanish. If you see, there's a lot of normal AMHs after 35 and around 40 as well in the first line. Whereas that's not the same with the red indicated bars. That implies that the AMH is different in Spanish and Indian women. So the conclusion of that study, which was published in Fertility and Sterility, was the similar ovarian reserve markers and ovarian response were observed in women with the 6-year age difference in favor of the Spanish women, suggesting ethnic differences are there in ovarian aging. That means if a Spanish woman of 36 year old and an Indian woman of 30 year old, they're likely to have similar ovarian reserve. So we are 6 years older than Spanish women in terms of ovarian reserve. And these results will help the clinicians to counsel infertile women who are discussing ART according to the Asian ethnic background. And not just the Spanish women, because I had the experience of working in the UK for a long time. And I've observed the same when I came and have been practicing in Nova here for the last 3.5 years. And there is significant difference even with the British women, where the ovarian reserve declines after 35, whereas in our women, Indian women here, we see a very, very early decline in ovarian reserve. So though a lot of studies say that above 35 are poor responders, all these studies are done in Western populations. So we have to correlate to our ethnic group. So we have clear evidence that ovarian reserve is likely to decline from 30 years itself in Indian women. And the other marker of ovarian reserve is antral follicle count. Follicles which measure 2 to 9 millimeter on day 2 or 3 of the cycle, and 2 to 7 millimeter follicles are even more healthier follicles. If there's less than 4 antral follicles, then the response is likely to be very poor or no response. 5 to 11 antral follicles also, we have low response and the risk of cancellation. 12 to 20 follicles likely to have a normal response, and more than 20 antral follicles, we have to be cautious of over response, and especially this can be in PCOS women. So what is anti-Mullerian hormone? It's a hormone which is expressed in pre-antral and small antral follicles. It disappears in mature pre-ovulatory follicles. So this is secreted by the granulosa cells of the recruited follicles until they become sensitive to FSH. It is a regulator of recruitment, preventing the depletion of all primordial follicle pool at once. So it prevents recruiting too many follicles so that the follicles are saved till the woman is around 45. And these mean serum AMH levels are more or less stable throughout the menstrual cycle. Unlike FSH, we don't need to worry that we need to do a particular time, day or whatever. So they are more or less stable throughout the cycle. But AMH levels do decrease with age, and that's after 30, you can see the decline, whereas after 35, it's much worse. So eggs and live birth rate in normal responders, this is a very, very, very useful paper which we quote in majority of the talks, because the higher the number of oocytes, the higher the live birth. Up to 15 follicles, but after that, 15 oocytes. After that, it plateaus up to 20. After 20, it's of not much use. So we need to aim to get about 15 follicles to get a good quality embryo and a live birth. So these are the cumulative live birth rates according to the response to the stimulation. So the higher the number of oocytes retrieved, if you can see on the bars on the right, so if we have only less than five, the live birth rate is extremely low. However, if we retrieve more oocytes, the live birth rate goes up to 68%. So this forms the mainstay of how we want to do stimulation. We want to get more number of oocytes so that the cumulative live birth rate, that is embryos which are formed as a result of oocyte retrieval from one IVF cycle. So if we do stimulation for one cycle, the number of embryos we get from that cycle and the number of live births we are able to achieve is the cumulative live birth rate. If it's a normal live birth rate per transfer, it doesn't take into account like how many stimulations they might have had. So how to do the antagonist protocol? Treatment starts on day 2 with the baseline scan. With the normal responders, we can start with 2 to 5 of or 200 of recombinant FSH or HMG on day 2 and start the antagonist in a fixed or flexible pattern on day 6 or when the follicle is 14 millimeters. And we can trigger once at least 3 follicles are more than 17 to 18 millimeters. With HCG in regular responders and do egg collection 36 hours later. So there is a risk of moderate to severe OHSS if we have more than 19 follicles of 11 millimeters and more at the time of trigger. So we have to be cautious what trigger we are choosing. So if we think even in regular responders we are at risk of OHSS, they can be triggered with a GnRH agonist, which can be triptorelin, which can be decapeptyl, which can be doserlin, instead of HCG. And we can perform the egg collection 36 hours later, like when we give HCG. And patients at risk of OHSS, we're going to freeze the embryos or oocytes. That is, we are not going to do a fresh transfer because that can aggravate OHSS. if they become pregnant. So how are we going to freeze the embryos or freeze the oocytes, which is better? Both are likely to be similar. They've given live birth rate. If you look at the numbers, they're very low. It's only 74 embryo transfers in the oocyte vitrification and 68 in the embryo vitrification. And this data is too small for us to tell whether to vitrify oocytes and have a similar live birth rate than embryos. So if we look at the success we have obtained with embryo vitrification compared to oocyte vitrification, embryo vitrification has been tried, tested and proved, and we have to wait for more studies before we consider oocyte vitrification for OHSS. And what is the starting dose if the age is less than 30? You can start with gonadotropins of 200 international units Recagon or 187.5 of Gonalef or 225 international units of urinary gonadotropin. And age 31 to 35, you may increase from 50 to 100 international units depending on the BMI and ovarian reserve of the patient. If they're more than 35, I would suggest starting on a higher dose straight away, minimum of 300. And we have to counsel them for poor ovarian response and even egg donation. However, if you are using a combination of recombinant and urinary gonadotropins, the highest you can go up to is 450 international units. And no study has proven effective more than 450 international units, whereas with recombinant, 300 is supposedly the highest that we can have any benefit by stimulating poor responders. PCOS, we need to also take into account their age and BMI. If they're young and thin, start with 150 of recombinant FSH. If they're more than 30 years and obese, you can slightly increase the dose by 25 to 50 units. And we need to scan after 5 days and adjust the dose if there's no response at all. And if there is response, we can also start the antagonist. So when the leading follicle is more than 14 millimeters or on day 6, and antagonist has to be given every 24 hours till the day of HCG, and normally 3 to 5 doses are required. This is a small algorithm which is used in NOVA centers. So day 2 we do a scan and then start the gonadotropins and scan again on day 7 and start antagonist. And rescan again into 3-4 days depending on the follicle size and trigger when 3 follicles are more than 17 millimeters. And the important aspect is on the day of triggering, ensure the interval between antagonist and HCG does not exceed 28 hours and egg collection 36 hours after the trigger. So luteal support can be started on the same after OPU, can be on the night of the OPU or the next day. And it's in the form of micronized progesterone 400 milligrams twice a day and tufestrone 10 milligrams twice a day. There is no need to add injectable progesterones routinely. This itself is more than enough to get good pregnancy rates, and it's been tried and tested and been proven in a lot of studies. The pregnancy test needs to be done on 14 days after the embryo transfer. And the beta HCG value more than 100 is good. They can be scanned after a couple of weeks. I usually tell them because if they get scanned after 7 days, sometimes they become very anxious if there is no fetal pole or fetal heart. So a couple of weeks ideally. And if it's less than 100, we need to repeat 48 hours later. And if it's less than 10, it's a negative value. So how do we do donor-recipient cycle? Donor, we have little flexibility, but recipient, because we've been following them up, we have a large window to plan. So we screen the donor suitability for anesthesia, counsel them, and check if their ovarian reserve is good. And recipient, we make sure suitability for pregnancy, that endometrium is receptive, and there's no medical reasons that they cannot have a pregnancy. And when we match both, we put on pills for both, and donor, we start an antagonist protocol. Recipient can be suppressed if she's having periods or not for patients with ovarian failure. Preparation of the recipient should start at least 2 days before stimulation of the donor. So the recipient receives tablet Progen over 2 milligrams, and then scan after 7 to 8 days, and then check the endometrium. If less, we can increase 2 milligrams twice daily vaginally as well, and the maximum is 12 milligram per day, and continue on the same dose till the day of OPU of donor. So luteal support, again, exactly the same, and we transfer day 5 embryos only. Just give me a second. I'll have to just start a different presentation, which is not saved on this. Sorry. Okay, so the embryo transfer needs to be done 5 days later after starting. Usually in our practice, we only transfer day 5 embryos, but rarely, then you know, day 3 transfer due to any other reasons, it's 3 days after starting the progesterone. And if you look at the poor responders, what do we do? What are the choices with poor responders? If they don't develop a follicle, or if they do develop and they don't have eggs, or if they do have eggs and they are not of good quality, or they're average quality but does not result in an embryo. So we can use various preparations, recombinant FSH, HMG with clomiphene citrate. So there is a retrospective analysis of 46 women who are poor responders according to the Bologna criteria. We can accumulate the embryos or oocytes. We can use minimal ovarian stimulation or conventional ovarian stimulation. When they mean by minimal ovarian stimulation, we're only using very minimal amount of drug, unlike 300 or 450 international units. They restrict to only 150 up to 150 international units. So the objective is the ovarian response any different, or the embryo quality? So if you look at this comparison between minimal stimulation and conventional ovarian stimulation, dose of gonadotropins is significantly less with minimal stimulation. Oocytes retrieved are better. M2 oocytes are better with minimal stimulation. Gonadotropin amount is less. E2 levels on the last day of stimulation are higher, which is good. Progesterone level is more or less the same. No significant difference. Number of fertilized oocytes are also higher in minimal stimulation significantly. Good quality embryos are also similar, and amount of gonadotropin is per embryo is also significantly lower. So why don't we all use the minimal stimulation then is the question. There is a very high cancellation rate for minimal stimulation protocols that's been excluded, hence we are getting these results. So if the patient is counseled regarding cancellation, probably we can also try the minimal stimulation protocol. So how are we going to manage with the poor responders safe effectively? Yeah, we can by ovum donation. So we use donor egg in these group of patients. That's a very easy option that all of us are well known to. However, to help us further, there has been some advancement in the form of the Poseidon concept, where they have grouped the suboptimal or poor responders into 4 groups, group 1, 2, 3, 4. Group 1 is young and suboptimal response. Group 2 is old and suboptimal response. Group 3 is young and expected low oocyte number, where the ovarian reserve is low. And group 4 is old and expected low oocyte number. So in group 1 and 3, we have young patients. Hence, the risk of aneuploidy in the embryo is lower. In group 2 and 4, we have older patients, hence the risk of aneuploidy of the embryo is very high. So we can also decide the gonadotropin starting dose and regime categorized by Poseidon-based stratification. So the first group is absolutely straightforward. These are non-Poseidon patients. If you start from group 1, 2, 3, and 4, it decreases the chances. That is the prognosis. So group 1, where they're less than 30 years of age, I mean, it says 35, but as we can collate to our population, we can take it as 30. We can start with the low dose of 100 to 175 with the antagonist protocol. If you come to group 2, the same, we can increase it up to 200 to 250. Or add LH as well as the recombinant FSH in the ratio of 2:1. In someone, and FSH and LH or FSH alone. If you come to group 4, they only advise to use recombinant FSH along with recombinant LH in 2:1 ratio. So this is likely to give better results, is what the Poseidon concept says. If we come to this group 1, young, that is, they have adequate rhizome, they have good quality embryos because they are young. However, they're likely to hyporespond. So if you can see the circle, where I've circled with the yellow marker, the recombinant FSH dose up to 225 should be okay. And because they're younger grouping patients, we can try elective embryo transfers using their own oocytes in this group of patients. Whereas in group 2, we can go up to 300 international units because they're above 30 to 35 years. So the risk of embryo aneuploidy is high. However, they're likely to hyporespond. So we go up to a higher dose. And embryo transfer, also 12 embryos are considered. However, oocyte donation might also be an option, or pre-implantation genetic testing in the older, I mean, because of their age and aneuploidy risk should also be discussed. So coming to group 3, young patients, there is poor reserve. But because their age is low, they have good quality embryos and aneuploidy risk is low. Because of the poor reserve, they can go on dual stimulation, that is, they get stimulated twice in the same cycle, and stimulation needs to be done with a higher dose of recombinant FSH of up to 300. And group 4 are the worst performing patients, where the oocyte quality is poor and embryo quality is poor and the reserve is poor. Aneuploidy risk is high. So we go up to 300 of recombinant or 450 of HMG. We can also consider dual stim in this group of patients. Stimulation part is more or less the same when the reserve is low. However, we have to consider PGS or PGT for older group patients, or also consider oocyte donation. Whereas with younger patients, we can try more with self oocytes. So if you see, if the reserve is low, we need at least 12 oocytes to get one aneuploid embryo in someone with advanced age. But if the age is less and the reserve is poor, we only need 4 to 5 oocytes to get one euploid embryo. So what this means is, it really helps a lot if the patients can have their own eggs, because it gives them immense satisfaction. So the chances of having an euploid embryo is much higher at a younger age relative to older age group. So we have to counsel them during their fertility journey if they're needed to go for higher treatment. The reason why they need to go, because it's not only the success rate, but also the quality of the embryos and the need for PGS or PGT, and also the need may arise to go for oocyte donation. So this is another concept which has been developed. So what are the ways we can deal the poor responders? We can increase the dose. We can lower the dose of agonist, we can use the flare-up protocol, stop protocol, ultra-short, short. And there's various agents that have been tried, and of them, the main ones are the DHEA, testosterone, letrozole, growth hormone, and natural cycle, aspirin, so on. And there is one study which says that prayer group gets higher pregnancies. I'm not sure if this was ever reproduced again, but what I have come across in my clinical practice is patients who are not very anxious or less stressed are likely to have better outcomes. If you see the live birth rate and ovarian aging, it significantly declines from 30 and it's even worse after 40s. And the miscarriage rate similarly goes up significantly. So the if you see more eggs are fertilized at a younger age, whereas less eggs are fertilized at a higher. So what we need to remember is oocyte quality and age are beyond repair. So wasting our time and their time, we need to seriously consider what are the treatments they can have instead of fighting against oocyte quality and age. And we cannot stimulate if there are no follicles. So there's no, if we cannot see a follicle on the scan, then it's unlikely to grow. So we need to counsel the patient, show them and make them understand if they're really, even if they're really unwilling to go for any treatment. And not every patient is the same. So we always have to individualize. So again, as we see, these are the same studies which are saying declining fertility significantly from 30 years of age and increasing risk of miscarriage after 30. So at the age of 40, 77% of the oocytes are aneuploid. So this was studied on based on a software-based evaluation. And as I said in the Poseidon concept, at least we need 10 to 12 oocytes to get one euploid blastocyst. So the facts are, if you see from 42 years of age, the success rate significantly goes down of the live birth of self-oocytes is only 4.2, 3.3 and 0.6. So in this age group, even if they push us for treatment, we really need to convince them because it's not ethically justifiable for us to put them through all that. So there are a few important points of controlled ovarian stimulation from the ESHRE guideline, which probably many of you are also using in your routine practice. I'll come to those at the end. So in over responders, that is PCO patients, GnRH antagonist protocol is safe and efficacious and it's strongly recommended. And for any other group of patients apart from PCO, if they're likely to respond too much, antagonist protocol is ideal. We don't need to add clomiphene for high responders, and there is insufficient evidence to recommend the addition of letrozole to gonadotropins in high responders. So the antagonist protocol is the best for high responders, and it also reduces the risk of OHSs. So there is no evidence to justify the use of natural cycle or modified natural cycle for ovarian stimulation in high responders. So, and coming to the next one, normal responder, GnRH agonist protocol is recommended for normal responder as well with regards to safe. And there is no evidence to support use of clomiphene in stimulation protocols even for normal responders, as well as letrozole is not recommended. And a reduced gonadotropin dose is not recommended over a conventional gonadotropin dose for normal responders. Say if you want to just do a minimal stimulation protocol, that's not fine. So they need to be started with conventional to give a higher. So GnRH antagonist and agonist are equally recommended for poor responders. So far we've seen high responders, antagonist protocol, normal responders, antagonist protocol without clomiphene, letrozole. Now coming to poor responders, both the protocols are equally effective. Clomiphene citrate can be recommended along with gonadotropin for predicted poor responders. Letrozole is not recommended. It is unclear whether a higher gonadotropin dose is recommended over 150 for predicted poor responders. And higher than 300 definitely not recommended. And modified natural cycle is not recommended over conventional stimulation. If GnRH agonists are used, the long agonist protocol is recommended over short or ultra short agonist protocol where agonist is given at the beginning of the period. So the GnRH antagonist protocol is recommended over agonist protocol given the comparable efficacy and higher safety. as both are efficient, antagonist gives more flexibility to the patient. So it's shorter duration and its action is reversible immediately. Antagonist is more patient friendly as well as doctor friendly. And lately there have been use of progestin for suppression of LHP, but it's not routinely recommended. And especially when we are planning fresh transfer, it's not at all recommended. The use of recombinant FSH and HMG are equally recommended. So whether it's a recombinant or a unary gonadotropin, both are equally recommended. If we see the use of recombinant FSH and purified FSH for ovarian stimulation, in agonist protocol is equally recommended. And recombinant FSH and highly purified FSH, the previous was only purified. Even these two are recommended for agonist protocol. So highly purified FSH and HMG are also equally recommended for agonist protocol. For when using recombinant LH plus FSH is not recommended over HMG in agonist protocol with regards to its safety. So this is conditional, the evidence is not strong, so there is some flexibility. Letrozole is not recommended as a substitute for gonadotropins in poor responders. So there is also no evidence to substitute FSH by clomiphene with poor responders. The use of long-acting and daily recombinant FSH is equally recommended in antagonist cycle for normal responders. So there is a long-acting FSH product which can be used, not just the daily one. However, its action is not reversible, hence we need to be cautious when we are using. So both of them can be equally used if you are fairly confident of that the patient is likely to respond. Adjustment, that is increase or decrease of gonadotropin dose in the mid-stimulation phase, is not recommended. So once the response starts, that is the follicles grow, whether they are few or many, we are not supposed to change the dose in the middle of the cycle. It's unlikely to be of any benefit. So these are the main next things that we all need to be very cautious about. LH suppression and ovarian stimulation, which adjuvant therapies and non-conventional protocols. So we all know that we've been using metformin for PCO patients. However, routine use of metformin before and or during stimulation is not recommended on GnRH antagonist protocol for women with PCOS. So in PCOS women, we don't need to use metformin with antagonist protocol. And the same stands for growth hormone as well. Use of testosterone before stimulation is not recommended for poor responders. Use of DHEA before and during ovarian stimulation is not recommended for poor responders. So this is based on conditional evidence, not by an RCT or something. So we need to be very cautious about using these medications routinely. And use of aspirin before and or during stimulation is not recommended for poor responders. Use of sildenafil is also not recommended for poor responders. Random start ovarian stimulation is also not recommended routinely. Late luteal phase start of gonadotropin also is not recommended for poor responders. So early luteal phase start of gonadotropin is also not recommended for poor responders. That means there is a theory that the follicles do develop in waves. So whenever we see more antral follicles, we can start the stimulation. That is used in certain conditions, which I'll go through next. But routinely, we're not supposed to start randomly or late luteal or early luteal phase because it can compromise the oocyte quality. So luteal phase stimulation, when can we use it, is in non-transfer cycles when we're not planning to transfer. Like double stimulation in poor responders should be used only in the context of clinical research. That is, double stimulation is we start and then we finish the egg collection by mid-cycle. But we continue the agonist for a few more days and then start stimulation again in the luteal phase. So we are doing two stimulations in the same cycle. That is only used in research context. We are not supposed to use routinely. Double stimulation can also be considered for urgent fertility preservation cycle. So someone who is waiting to have chemotherapy, they do not have much time, we can use double stimulation in those cases. For ovarian stimulation in women seeking fertility preservation for medical reasons, the antagonist protocol is recommended. And oncology fertility preservation cycles, we also can do a random start stimulation. That is, they just come to us and they say, we only have 10 days or 2 weeks before chemotherapy, or sometimes they say even less time. So in such cases, we can just start the stimulation at any time. In ovarian stimulation for fertility preservation and estrogen sensitive diseases, that is, if there's a breast cancer which is estrogen receptor positive, we need to use anti-estrogen therapy along with gonadotropin, such as letrozole or tamoxifen. So that's the end of the talk for stimulation protocols. So today I was exclusively covering on the stimulation protocols. There's a lot of other things during the stimulation, before, after, depending on various conditions. But to start for the basic, I think we've covered. And if you have any further questions, please let me know and I'll answer today, or you can also send me in the chat box. Are there any questions?
Yes, ma'am, I'm checking out.
Hello. Are there any questions?
Ma'am, I'm looking to check questions, ma'am. I'll let you know. Dr. Hema Prasanna, Dr. Hema Prasanna garu, how to treat OHSS, ma'am?
Hello.
Ma'am, am I audible?
Any questions?
Yes, ma'am. Dr. Hema Prasanna garu.
Hello.
Ma'am.
Dr. Hema Prasanna garu, how to treat OHSS, ma'am?
Okay, I think there is a topic on that. How to treat OHSS, that will be taken tomorrow by my colleague, I suppose. But basically, more than treating, we need to prevent it, which I have covered. Basically, we need to see if there's more than 15 to 20 follicles or high estrogen level more than 3000. Then we need to give a agonist trigger instead of a HCG trigger, and do not do a fresh transfer in that cycle. But in spite of that, if they develop OHSS, there's a lot of things which we need to take care, like what is their serum albumin level, what are the renal functions like, and the bottom line is we have to maintain the intravascular protein content. So serum albumin levels need to be maintained to prevent extravascular loss, third space loss. So once the third space loss minimizes, renal functions improve, and once we don't do a fresh transfer, the HCG levels come down. HCG is the main reason for OHSS, so that will help. But you'll have a more detailed talk on that, and after that I'll be talking on the last day regarding adjuvants, and after that if you still have any other doubts, I'm more than happy to clarify. Any more questions?
Ma'am, we will wait for at least one minute, ma'am, so that we can see the queries, ma'am. So, okay, doctors, sure. You can unmute and ask your queries, or else you can share your queries in chat room also, ma'am. I'm just checking out, ma'am. If any queries, definitely I'll share, ma'am. So I have one announcement, ma'am. So following this IVF stimulation protocols, tomorrow we have another important session on monitoring of an IVF cycle and luteal phase support, sharp at 4 p.m., ma'am. ma'am, as of now, no questions, ma'am.
Okay.
We'll say thanks to the doctors. Thank you so much to all the doctors for spending your valuable time with Nova IVF Basic Infertility Training Program, Dr. Garu. Ma'am, please convey your time.
Thank you to all of you for joining our Basic Infertility course, and it's a pleasure to be able to share our knowledge and interact with one another. If you have any further questions, you can always ask me on the last day, and also most of you have my phone number, and if you don't, by all means, I'll share it in the next presentation or my email. I would like you all to gain as much as possible, and I also would like to learn from you all. So thanks for joining us. Thank you.
So Kavita ma'am said thanks to you, ma'am. Nice presentation.
Thank you. Thank you, Kavita Garu.
We can end up, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, Swapna, ma'am.
Thank you.
Ma'am, the session was completed, ma'am. So tomorrow we have another session at sharp 4 p.m. ma'am. So we can left from the group, ma'am. Thank you.
प्रदान के लिए दी। Thank you.